We'll start by clicking on the Interact menu and create a new simulation. I will select the factory environment. I can select other, but this is just some kind of skybox and model just to give you some kind of environment. And here, for this demo, I will select the desktop viewer. But this is exactly the same thing if you want to do a VR demo, for example, using a Vive headset or an Oculus headset. You just select which device you want to use, and every configuration, every preference in Unity will be set up as desired. So let's select desktop just because it's a bit easier for webinar. And I don't have special tracking devices here, but again, it will be if, for example, you have some Vive tracker and you need to track full body using some kind of motion capture suit, this device could be quite useful, and also some less common devices, but you just need to click and everything will be configured and set up for Interact. So, okay, so I have my scene. So the second thing that we usually do in every simulation is to import your 3D data. So in the last webinar, we saw how to import your point cloud data, but you can also import your CAD data thanks to Pixiz, or your BIM data thanks to Unity Reflect. It will work as well. But for CAD data, you can go to Interact, Import, and import a CAD model. I have already imported some model before, so here I will just drag this asset into my scene. But if you import your CAD data, you will have exactly the same thing, and you will be able to import all the CAD file formats that Pixiz handle, like CATIA, SolidWorks, GT, and so on. Okay, so I have a small machine here. Let's make this machine move. So I will first unpack this prefab. What we will try to do here is quite simple. We have here a part that should translate like this. And we have another part here that should translate like that. Of course, this part should follow this one, and all the kinematics will be handled. We can move on the X and Y, X and Z axis for all this part. So I'll just reset the position. So when you define the kinematic, you need to tell the physics engine which part will move and what constraint there is. So the first thing that we will do is to set up this part, this kind of base, as the fixed part. This is our grounded part. It won't move at all, but it will tell the physics engine, okay, this is the first part, and we can link the other part to this one after. So I have selected my part. I will maybe select this one in the hierarchy, because I don't know if it could have some kind of sub part. You can select any level of hierarchy that you want. I will right click on this part, go to Interact menu, and select Physicalize. There is some kind of pop-up here, and you can select the joint type that you want to use. So for this one, we don't want this to move at all, so it will be a fixed joint. So let's click on OK, and we can see that it added two mono behavior, two components. The first one is an XD rigid body, which just tells that this part will be handled by our physics engine. We can already see that there's several components to set, so for example, some kind of mass, or to change the material, which can be useful for contact and friction, for example. So something like that. The fixed joint is not really interesting because it just tells that it fixed. So let's do something a bit more interesting. We will physicalize this part. Again, we go to the interact, physicalize menu. But this time, we will select a prismatic join because we want this part to translate around the first part. So again, it created two mono behaviors. So the first one is the rigid body as well. And the second one is the XD prismatic joint, which will tell our physics engine, okay, this part can move. Just a quick note on this. XD physics engine used what we called reduced coordinate to describe the kinematics. So it's something really useful for robotics because it's a mathematical approach where instead of considering that every object is free and you want to constrain every axis that can't move, with reduced coordinate, you do see quite the opposite. In fact, you only define in the mathematical solver the degree of freedom that should move. This means that with this part, even if my solver, even if my physics engine is not precise enough, my part won't move at all in the other axis because it's not even in the physics engine. By default, on a game engine like physics, you usually use maximal coordinates, so every coordinates are in the solver, and you introduce some kind of mathematical constraints to say, okay, this object won't move on this axis, and so on. But for example, with a great amount of effort or forces, this constraint can be violated, and your object can move a little bit in the other direction. So here, this is a big strength of the physics engine because it provides a lot of stability for robotic simulation and complex kinematics. Okay, so when I added this prismatic joint, I had some kind of gizmo here, which describe in which direction this part should move. And we can notice that there is already some kind of problems because this part here will move to, along the red axis, and we want this part to move along the blue axis. So let's zoom a little bit, and we have some convenient tools to set up the axis when you click on the pick axis button, and when you drag and drop, when you drag your mouse around, it will highlight all the CAD feature of your model, and it will propose you some useful axis. This is especially useful for rotation and when you have some kind of hole, for example, because you don't have any geometry in here, and it kind of detects that this could be a candidate axis, and you can really set up axis very easily and very quickly with this. It's very similar to how CAD tool works, like CATIA, SolidWorks. So our customer already know how to use this kind of tool. They are used to this tool. So let's say I just want to move in this direction. Okay. One last thing is that I need to define a parent body, because this part will move according to this body that we define as our default body, our ground. So let's set up the parent body. So I think it was this one. And we'll do exactly the same operation for this part. Select the part, click on physicalize. Again, it's a prismatic joint. The axis is not in the right direction, so maybe use pick axis. Up like that, it's perfect. And I select the parent body because it will move along the XY part. Okay. I think we will have a quick look about the prismatic joint component before hitting play and see what we have done here. You can notice some useful checkbox here. For example, if you want to use some kind of minimum and maximum limit, you can just click on this checkbox and the gizmo will update, and you can set up the maximum amount of translation that your part is allowed to go. So I don't know the exact value, but maybe let's set up something like that. One other thing that could be quite useful is to add a bit of friction, because in every system you have a friction. It will be much more realistic with some kind of friction. This is in Newton. So if you have some kind of technical documentation and you really want to simulate this precisely, you can usually find the value in the technical documentation of your machine. Okay. So here I have defined some kind of kinematic constraint, but I didn't tell my physics engine which movement I want to make. So if I hit play right now, it will work, but it will be quite boring because everything will be static. So let's see how we can move things regarding to this kinematic constraint. There is several way to do this. The first one is when you want to simulate the actuator, all the actuator of the machine, or how much how will it go if this engine push the part and so on. So if you really need to simulate all the actuator, you can add, for example, a joint effort. It will add another behavior, and you can select an effort here in Newton, and it will tell the prismatic it will apply a force of this number of Newton in this kinematics joint. So let's try this. Let's go to the scene. And if I apply an effort of maybe 1 Newton, you can see the seat part will move and stop because we define a max limit. Okay, so of course, if I press minus, it will move in the other direction and stop because we have our min and max limit again. Okay, so this component is really useful when you want to simulate all the actuator, but it means that you need to have some kind of controller. This is useful, for example, if you connect this with an other tech. For example, if the customer already have all the robots controller, and this controller, usually you would put some kind of forces, and you plug the forces into this component, and it will be simulated in our physics engine. But this kind of control is quite complicated to use. For example, here, if I want to just say for this part to reach a specific position, this is not really the right controller to use. So we can see some other controller. So you have, for example, the proportional derived coupling, which is something that will add some kind of spring forces to go to a desired position. So you set up the desired position of the joint. So when it's initialized, it's at zero. And you can say, okay, go to this specific position, and you will specify some kind of parameter, which is the forces of the spring to reach this position. So this one is a bit more useful because you can precisely say, okay, just move to this position, and the physics engine will compute all the forces needed to reach the position. It's good, but it's useful when you only want to control one joint. Here, we have some kind of combination because we have a joint which will move in this direction, in the blue axis, and another joint that will move in the red axis. So this kind of controller is not the most useful when you have some kind of combination. It's more when you have only one joint, or when you want to precisely write your own controller. So we'll see a source way to control your robots, your machine. Just before switching to the other way to control, you can notice some button here, add monitor. Monitor is quite useful to debug your simulation and to know what happened. It will add again some mono behavior, and you will see in real time when you hit play the current position of your link, of your joint, and the current velocity. It's really useful. For example, I often write some kind of quick script to graph this value, or maybe to export this in kind of comma separated values. If you want to study the movement of your part, it's very useful to export data, and with this component you can extend you can retrieve the value and extend it to other tools. So let's delete all our controller, and we'll show our source way to control things, and this time it will tell our system to reach a specific position, and the physics engine will compute all the needed position of all the link. It won't be on just one unit joint, but for all the joints, it will try to reach a specific position. So this kind of controller, we call this manipulator. And if you want to manipulate the thing with this, you can go, as always, on the interact menu, go to physics, and add a manipulator. This manipulator will be the desired target that we want to reach according to our kinematic constraint. We can use quite a lot of tracking devices to set up this target. But here we will keep things simple, and we will just use some kind of XYZ transform, which is a unity transform right there. And when we will move this transform, our system will try to reach the position of our manipulator. So let's hit play and try that. Let's go to the scene. I can move my manipulator, and you can see that this part translates as needed. It will stop because it's limited by our minimum limit on the joint. So even if my target is outside, this machine can't reach this position. Again, if I move this up, it won't move at all because there is absolutely no degrees of freedom to move up. And if I just move in the two axis, we can see that it will follow on each axis to reach the position. Okay, so we already have some kind of physics simulation. And one other thing that is very important in the physics engine is collision. Here, I didn't specify any collision. So if I want to move along this part, it will intersect, and I have absolutely no feedback at all when this happens. So let's stop the simulation and set up some kind of collision. So we will select this part. Again, we will physicalize it. This part will be fixed. And what we want to check here, we will go to the collision matrix on the physics menu. We have a collision matrix here. Okay, so we have here some kind of layer for collision. So on this layer, we will set up our physics object. With this kind of matrix here, we can set up that, for example, the default layer containing some physics object. So if I select this, I can see all the physics objects that are present in this layer. And the ground is just the default environment. If I select this layer, I can see that I have pretty much all the physics objects that I have added. And I don't want to add collision between all of these objects right now. I just want to add collision between this object and this one, for example. So I will create a new layer here, which I will call, for example, static layer. I will set up all the fixed object in this layer. And I will set up a new layer again, and let's call this moving part. Okay, this layer actually are empty. Did not define any object in this. So let's populate this layer. I want this part to go on the static layer. So if I just click on this part, maybe go a bit up on the hierarchy, and I will on the XDV rigid body here, I can just select the layer that I want to where I want to add this part, and let's select the static layer. You can notice that in the hierarchy, we have some kind of reminder of which layer this rigid body is. Okay, let's do the same thing for the other part, this part here. Maybe let's add this to the moving part. And okay, so if I click here on the static layer, I should have this part, and here on the moving part, the other part. I want to define the collision between this layer and the other one. So I need to check in this kind of matrix here, the intersection between static layer and moving part. So for example, I will select, it will be in this item. And if I click on this, it will switch to a red button, and it will mean that we will activate contact between static layer and moving part. If I click again, it will switch to interference. Interference means that we will detect collision, but we won't have any reaction to this. It will just tell us, okay, this part intersect with the other part, but we don't have some kind of feedback of forces reaction. So let's select contact. Due to some kind of it's a bit complicated, but right now you have to also click on the checkbox near the button. We hope to improve this user interface in the future, but for some reasons we need to activate this manually right now. Okay, so we have defined two layers. We have defined the collision between the static layer and moving part. So if I just hit play, and again I will select my transform here, and if I, it will collide and prevent my path to go further. What is interesting here is that we don't care about if geometry is convex, non-convex, if it has a lot of triangles. Everything is handled by the physics engine. We can the collision is precise. We do not transform the geometry, for example, to split in convex or to limit this kind of geometry. You just need to physicalize, and it will be handled, and all the details are already set up. If you really need to go a bit further, you can notice that when we hit physicalize, it also added some kind of mesh collider, when in every part that has some mesh filter, mesh renderer. And this XDA mesh collider, you can I think these parameters could be useful. It's a dilatation parameters in meter. And it's important to use when you need to check that you have some kind of clearance, because you can just inflate the geometry a bit, just to have a bit of a margin when you do the collision detection. One other thing on collision detection is that typically in a physics engine, especially in game, we use what we called some kind of of penalty constraint, which means that when two parts are in interference, when two parts are colliding, but when the geometry is intersecting, we set up some kind of penalty coefficient to tell our physics engine, our solver, to try to move the part outside the other one on the next frame. This approach is really good for game. It works really well, it's really efficient, really it's a great thing. But for industrial simulation, we have a problem with this approach because it means that when you try to resolve the contact, the constraint, you are already inside the other part. So if you want to validate that some parts will fit, it's too late because you detect this when the parts are already colliding. So this is not how XD works. We can handle and resolve the constraint on the solver and without using some kind of penalty method. This is a much more mathematical. It's more of a mathematical method in the solver to resolve all the contact, all the constraint together, and be sure that when we have the physics engine output the position, we won't have any collision. It's really useful for industrial simulation, but sometimes it's a bit more difficult to configure for advanced scenario or when parts are moving really fast. So if you have any trouble when using this, don't hesitate to ask a question. There are a lot of parameters to fine-tune this kind of behavior and to keep the guarantee that your object won't intersect at all. Okay. I think we already covered quite a lot of things on kinematics.